and in collaboration with Delhi Post News, GenDev Center for Research and Innovation, and CDMakers Mission International. Today we have something very interesting, where we'll be talking on women's rights in the 21st century from the lens of a social activist. And the social activist that we have with us today, this evening, is a well-known, well-acclaimed activist person. You must all be knowing her. She's Shabnam Hashmi, who is a social activist, a rebel, a fearless fighter, and a human rights defender. She is an excellent organizer and a person who has generated ideas for thousands of creative campaigns and implemented them at the local as well as national level. Shabnam has been working as a social activist for more than 35 years. She founded and ran Sehel from 1981 to 1989, Sehmat from 1989 to 2003, which was formed after her brother Safdar Hashmi's murder. And after that, Anhad was formed in 2003 after Gujarat genocide, and recently she started a platform, India Inclusive. Her fearless actions against communal forces have invoked the wrath of divisive forces, and several times she has faced physical attacks. She was nominated for the Nobel Prize as part of the 1,000 women from across the world in 2005. She was awarded National Minority Rights Award 2008 by the National Minority Commission, which she returned last year to protest against the lynchings. She's among the handful of people who first spoke about the Sangh terror network in India. She has worked extensively in Gujarat, Kashmir, Bihar, along with work at national level. She works on questions related to democracy, secularism, gender rights, women's education and adoption. And friends, I have known Shabnam since 2003, and I've seen myself how on the ground she is pretty firm, and she's a great organizer, and she's part. In fact, recently they've started this Dwarka Women's Collective. She's in part also of Hum Agar Uthe Nahi To campaign. She supported many campaigns like Not In My Name and so on and so forth. I think I can go on and on. And there's a book to her credit called Dark Leaves of the Present. So maybe I'll come back later on Shabnam's work and all. I think, you know, she's doing something very fascinating, deeply churning as such. So we'll have Shabnam talk to us for about 25 odd minutes, and then we'll open for discussion. So over to you, Shabnam. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much, Indu, for inviting me here, and thank you, IMPRI, or IMPR, for inviting me to talk. I've been asked to speak about the women's rights in the 21st century India. And I want to begin by saying that if we are looking at the women's rights, it is not a homogeneous slate. It is not like that every woman in India is having similar rights, because there are different realities. There is one reality or one kind of understanding of women's rights in rural India, there is urban India, there is semi-urban India, and the realities are very, very different. It has been a very long battle for women in India to reach where they have. And also, it is important to say that we are, instead of going ahead, now seems to be going in the reverse direction. Because what we gained over decades, there is a very strong attack on that. I would like to remember today, since we are talking of women's rights, Savitribai Phule, who started probably the first school for women. And at that time, it was mid-19th century, 1848, if I'm not mistaken, when Savitribai Phule decided to open a school to educate girls. And that was a major challenge at that time. Because when she used to go to her school, there would be people who would be throwing mud at her, throwing stones at her, because she was teaching women, and it was considered an absolute no-no. You were not, so women were not supposed to be educated. From there, we progressed to our freedom struggle, the first war of independence, where we for the first time saw very active participation of women who revolted against the British, who fought against the British. And from 1915 onwards, we see that a large number of women joined the freedom movement. And by joining the freedom movement, the ideas of equality, ideas of justice, they started entering the whole discourse. A strong women's movement starts in India much later, probably from the 70s onwards, as I would remember it. In the sense, this is all history which I have just seen. But from the 70s, when I was still in school, we see a strong women's movement starting. By then, many women organizations had been formed and big networks had been formed. And our understanding of gender equality or gender justice today is very, very different from what it was, say, 50 years or 100 years ago. Because the kind of gender equality that we talk about today is a very modern concept. There are constantly, the various, especially religious groups, keeps telling us that, you know, in our religion, women are treated as goddesses or women have got all the rights. But the kind of gender equality that we believe in today, where men and women are absolutely equal, where we want them to be treated equally in every sense of the word, whether it is living together in one house, whether having similar rights to education, to work, to drawing equal pays, to respect, getting the same respect, it has to be on equal platform. But this kind of equality does not exist in any religion. So when we are told that, you know, in our religion, women are respected or in that religion, yes, there could be respect or the time at which that certain religion arrived. For those times, it was probably progressive for women and it did bring many progressive things. But when we look at it from the lens of the modern understanding of gender equality, we don't find that kind of gender equality anywhere. And because of that, because this gender equality is a new concept where men and women are equal on in every sense of the word, it does not go very well with a lot of forces. So on one hand, we have the women movements, which also have men in it. We have movements by LGBTQ communities, which are constantly fighting to get equal rights for women, both men and women. On the other hand, we have very strong conservative forces, retrogressive forces, which are trying to take the women back, which are, and patriarchal forces, very feudal forces, especially part of the India lives under feudalism still. I mean, it's a very different kind of situation in South Asia or in many other countries also, in Africa and in many other countries from the Western world, because India lives in various realities at the same time. For me, a struggle could be very different from a woman who's living in rural India or in a village or in a conservative family. So for different geographical areas, for different, even different communities, the struggle is very different. But there are many, many things which apply to everyone. We can't say that we have not gained anything. We have definitely, as women, as women rights, we have gained a lot of things. When we attained independence, the literacy rate at that time was extremely low. And from there, it was just about, I think, 12%, if I'm not mistaken. From there today, I mean, we don't have the figures for 2020, but the last survey was 2011. And at that point, the literacy rate has risen to over 74%, almost 75%. So there is a big difference in that. And we see thousands of women today in public life, in jobs, in any place that you go to, in police, in army, in politics. Politics, the percentage is very less in terms of the elected representatives. But in politics, you find a lot of women. And it is very different from if I look at my childhood and the number of women who were allowed to go out or participate in various programs or have jobs or, you know, live a life of the way they wanted to live, the number was very small. So it is not that we have not gained anything. We have had a prime minister who was a woman. We have had a president who was a woman. We had two Lok Sabha speakers who were women. We have a large number of women politicians and chief ministers. So on one hand, it looks that, you know, women are and have gained a lot since we started our journey. But there are still huge amount of challenges that are there in front of the women in India. And as I said, that there are people, there are women organizations, there are people who are working on gender equality on one hand, and there are forces who are constantly trying to take back the women to where they were, not even at the time of independence, but much before that. So there's a constant struggle, which has become a lot more difficult now in the last 6 years since the new government has arrived, and even the last few decades, because the kind of retrogressive ideas which have been pumped into our minds or pumped into the minds of the Indians, they are quite retrogressive. And we constantly see an attack on women's rights and very concerted efforts also on women's rights. I'll come to some of those examples in the end, but I want to talk about the other problem which women are facing constantly. From before the birth, the whole patriarchal mindset, mm-hmm. and the whole mindset which only wants a son, ensures that millions of girls are killed even before they are born. Even in this 21st century, every year, lakhs of girls do not come into the world because they are killed in what is called female feticide. They are killed even before they are born. Some of them are killed before they are 1 year or even 1 month because nobody wants to have a girl child. And it's a major problem. When a girl is born, there is extreme unhappiness in families because a girl is unwanted. A girl is supposed to be somebody else's property because her whole body is objectified. She's not an equal person. She's not an equal human being. She does not have rights of an equal citizen in this country. So from that birth itself and before birth, the discrimination starts. And there are child marriages. There are many, many challenges. Even when a girl has to get married, there would probably be not even 1% of people in India today, I don't have statistics, who are taking stands against dowry, who are saying that there is no question of any give and take. So the moment you agree to give dowry, the moment you agree to receive dowry, you are already establishing that a woman is not equal to a man because she has to be married off only with a dowry. The man who is accepting dowry is giving a clear message that I'm marrying this woman, but she's not equal to me because she has to bring money so that I accept her. And it is a major challenge in India. And unless we are able to fight this meanness, and it is because of dowry, it is because the parents think that when a girl grows up, we will have to spend a lot of money, that they decide to just kill her even before she's born. Or then there is a whole question of education, and which is as compared to earlier, yes, there is a large section of women who are educated and highly educated, but still there are a large section of women, and not only in rural India, even in urban India, we run a center for school dropouts for girls, and there are so many young girls who study up to fifth, and then there is a very drastic drop out because they cannot afford it, because of poverty, because of very conservative attitudes, because the girl helps for in the household work, and so on and so forth. In rural India, it is much more. And now with the new education policy that is coming, which is going to privatize a lot of education, and also which is talking of rationalizing the schools, and which means mainly closing down the schools at the village level and opening a bigger school at the district level, we are going to see that a large number of girls who were at least getting education till fifth or eighth, even they are going to drop down because the parents are not going to allow them to go and travel 5 or 10 kilometers. So all these are problems which are faced by women across India, somewhere less, somewhere more. Then the other major question is in the workforce. And I had taken out the data, which was quite alarming to me. As in 2004 and 5, women in workforce were 42.7%. And in 2017-18, it has reduced to 23.3%. And this is not even COVID. This is before COVID. We have already seen that during COVID, we have seen lacks of jobs being, just evaporating. And a large number of women have lost their jobs. After demonetization, a large number in lakhs women lost their jobs, especially in rural India. Women who work as farmers, women who are laborers who work for other people who have farms and who have land, they have lost their jobs in huge numbers. And they are facing, because of that, they have been thrown into total poverty. During the COVID, we saw how migrant workers and lakhs of them had to travel for hundreds of kilometers to walk home. And again, the people who have gone back, what is going to happen to their children's education? That is also a very big question. And so there are multiple attacks on women's rights, whether it is their education, whether it is their jobs. We have seen even the white-collared jobs disappearing. And if you remember when I think Jet closed down and other airlines just sent out their staff, large number of those women were, of those workers were women, because of they were either working on the ground or they were air hostesses and so on and so forth. And these kind of jobs have been lost everywhere. Even when the jobs are there, whether it is unorganized sector, whether it is organized sector, whether it is women working in Bollywood, their salaries are not at par. Women are not treated as equal. Women's salaries are much, much lower depending on where they are working. So there is a lot to fight about. The challenges are huge. And instead of creating a situation where women can thrive, where women can be treated as equally, we are constantly facing attacks on women's rights. There have been, and these are attacks by those who run this country, because there has to be a political will if you want women to be treated equally. The domestic violence during the pandemic has grown many, many times. I mean, I don't have any data with me because I'm not a very academic person, but domestic violence has increased, and domestic violence has always been there. It has always been there. When a woman goes to complain, the way she's treated by the police, we have a totally anti-women, totally gender insensitive police and administration, even the judiciary. And we are not serious about sensitizing our police force, sensitizing our administration, sensitizing our judiciary on this question of gender. So these are major challenges which women of India face. But I want to bring in, I was given 25 minutes. I want to bring in 2-3 things, which I will have to look at my notes. One is that I was talking about the women farmers. 65.1% of the agricultural laborers are women. Either they are cultivators or laborers. And during this, the last, after Notbandi, after GST, and now pandemic, lakhs of women have lost their jobs. Also, when we talk of farmer suicides, we actually, a woman's face never comes in anyone's mind. When you talk of a farmer suicide, you think of a man who is committing a suicide. Out of the 3,32,000 farmer suicide, more than almost 20,000 were women farmers who committed suicide. So on one hand, women are being forced into a situation where they cannot sustain their agriculture because of various policies and the loans not being, we have huge amount of money maaf karna kehte hain, hum bade bade jo poonjipati hain, unke loans hum maaf hamari sarkar kar rahi hai. लेकिन फार्मर्स के लोन्स जो है उनको माफ नहीं किया जा रहा. एज अ रिजल्ट फार्मर्स आर यू नो फोर्स्ड इनटू कमिटिंग सुसाइड्स. एंड आउट ऑफ दिस फिगर नाउ दिस 3 lakh प्लस फार्मर्स हु हैव कमिटेड सुसाइड हु आर मेन, सडनली यू हैव हाउसहोल्ड्स वेयर द वुमन इज लेफ्ट टू रन दैट हाउसहोल्ड व्हेन द मैन हैज गॉन. एंड शी हैज नो मोर, मेजॉरिटी ऑफ दीज वुमेन are do not have the ownership rights on the land. It is either in the man's name, or once he dies, it then goes to the family and encroaches upon it, even if they had land. Most of them are anyway just working as laborers. So as I said, the realities for different sections of women are very different. For somebody, it's a question of the bare survival, whether they can, they would survive and have 2 meals a day. For some, it is a question of getting the basic education. For some, it is a question of fighting for equal rights within their families. And in the middle of all this, we have political forces which are bent upon, dragging the women back to the dark ages. I want to give you 3-4 examples. We have heard various political leaders giving these statements that Hindu women should produce 10 kids so that Hindus remain in majority. Now to, for their own false narrative, which they have been building for years to spread hatred and to spread communalism in this country, where they say that the Muslim produce a lot of children and because of that, their percentage is going to become much higher and we will become a minority one day. So they are telling Hindu women that you must produce 10 children or 6 children, which means that a Hindu woman does not have the, the capacity to think that you want to totally control her sexuality, you want to control her body, and you are telling her that it is not your decision what you want to do in your life, whether you want to produce a child or you don't want to produce a child, whether you want to get married or not get married, but you have to produce certain number of children because we want our political narrative to be spread across the country. There is an organization called Garb Vigyan Sanskar and Arogya Bharti and Vidya Bharti. They have been doing live trials for almost 10 years now. And they are propagating, and it is exactly the copy of what Hitler did. Hitler had said that we must raise the birth rate of racially pure, blue-eyed, fair and tall Aryan boys. It has been picked up from there, and this is what Garb Vigyan Sanskar is doing. Their aim is to produce 2,000 children by 2020, which are called Uttam Santati, who would have pure blood, who would be, tall and handsome, and so on and so forth. And they are doing these experiments on women bodies, because they are not going to produce children. They are doing these all experiments on women bodies. Then I remember reading about in a paper, a journalist had written about it, that she was traveling and she came across these shakhas, which were they were holding training camps for girls, where they teach the girls the and in fact indoctrinate, I should say, not teach, indoctrinate, that girls have to grow up and they have to become good homemakers, they have to become good wives and good mothers. There is no concept of a woman as a human being, as an equal citizen, who has a right to work, who has a right to live her own life, who has a right to love, and who has a right to get married according to her own wishes. And these are regular trainings which are given to girls in across India, especially in rural India, in tribal India. And when this journalist asked this director who was there, who was in charge of the camp, she asked them, what about domestic violence? I mean, what do you teach the girls about domestic violence? Because if they, when they get married and if they are abused, then what should they do? Her reply was, and this was in a newspaper, I have taken it out from there. Her reply was that the wife must adjust to keep in mind her husband's moods and should not irritate him. So on one hand, we are fighting to get equal rights. We are fighting for equal dignity. We are fighting for equal jobs. And on the other hand, we have these forces who are teaching women that your only role is of daughters or wives and mothers. There is no other role. And it is not confined to, I have quoted RSS, it is not confined only to the RSS. I remember in 2010, and that was one of the reasons why we decided to travel across India for 33% reservation. There is this Muslim cleric, Kalbe Jawad. When the question of 33% reservation came and the women groups were fighting for it in parliament and assemblies, he gave a statement. He said, Muslim women have nothing to do with politics. Their role is to produce children of good race. That is what he had said. So when it comes to the mentality, the patriarchal, feudal, anti-women mentality, there is no difference between whether that person belongs to religion A or religion B. And these forces are just taking back women, constantly pushing back women. Recently, I read, this happened in October. I mean, it was reported in October. As everyone knows, that tribal villages and tribal people, they are a lot more open about the choice of whom you marry, whom you love. And it has been a tradition in tribal society that the girls always select their own partners. But with this kind of attack which is coming in the against intercaste marriages, against interreligious marriages, we have already seen what happened to the Tanishka. And this whole bogey of love jihad, which they are saying that it's the Muslim boys who take away the Hindu girls and so on and so forth. Everyone knows about that. Although the reality is that there are equal number of Muslim women who are also marrying Hindu boys or who are marrying Christian boys. But we don't discuss that. We don't talk about that because that narrative does not fit into the narrative that the right wing wants to project. So in tribal belts, this is a case from Devgar Badia, where now what has started, that if a tribal girl wants to marry on her own or falls in love and decides her own partner, then the whole village leaders, they get together. And this was a case where in 2019, a girl had, eloped with her, with the person whom she loved. She was brought back. And now they have started that any girl who decides to marry on her own, she will be taken away and she would be auctioned. And there was this auction happening. And when this organization called Anandi from Gujarat, it's a women's organization, they intervened, they reached there with women and they stopped it. And there is another case going on in Godhra. There is another case from Gogamba. And there are many cases from this tribal belt. So, this was unimaginable. As I said, instead of going ahead, we are going backwards. Auctioning a girl because she has decided to marry her on her own. And constantly what we keep hearing that the Hindu girls are, I mean, what are you trying to say? That the Hindu girl doesn't have faculty to think? We do not want young people to fall in love with each other. We want to control everything. These are forces which are very, very, not only conservative fundamentalists, but anti-women. And they are dragging us back. And that is, I feel that, all other things that I spoke about, there are many challenges. But the major challenge is that in the society, unless you have forces who believe in gender equality, the kind of gender equality that the Indian constitution has given women of India, where every woman has to be treated equally in every sense of the word. Unless we are able to, you know, have progressive voices much more louder, much bigger in numbers, women equality and women rights are going to come under a major attack. We are already under a major attack by these conservative forces, and in both, because of the last 10, 15 years of communalization, which has grown in the country, and the anti-Muslim propaganda which has happened in the country, and the hatred which is there today in the country. We cannot deny it. There is hatred towards the Muslim. Because of that, what happens that once you attack a community, that moves inwards, and that starts looking at that probably, you know, you start losing your trust on many things. You don't trust the police, you don't trust the state, you don't trust. So you think that only I can only be safe within my own religion. And you start moving inwards. And that is what has happened to the Muslim community. And as a result, the fundamentalist Muslim organizations, they have now a much bigger hold on the Muslim community than what they had 20, 30 years ago. And when conservative and fundamentalist religious forces take over a community or become more powerful, then the first attack comes on women's rights. And that is what is happening on both the sides. It is happening on both the sides. I don't know about the Christian community or the Sikh community so much, what is happening in their communities. But on Muslim women and on Hindu women, and on every single citizen of this country, every single woman of this country, because of the rise of the fundamentalist, conservative, communal forces, fascist forces, the attack which has come on women's rights is a major, major challenge. And unless we are able to tackle that, we will not be able to even think of gender equality. We have already seen how the number of women has decreased in the workforce drastically from 2004 to 2017-18. And it'll, you know, go down further if we do not resist the communal fascist forces in this country. And last thing which I want to say is that we cannot look at any single issue in isolation. Every single social issue is connected to whatever else is happening in the country. So you cannot say that we would, you know, have a situation where women would be treated equally, but communalism can sustain, or economy can keep on going down the drain, but the women would have a very nice life. It is not possible. If economy goes down the drain, then women are going to lose jobs, and women are going to become economically dependent or reach a position of poverty. If communal forces and the fundamentalist and patriarchal forces become stronger, then women's roles are going to be confined, and they will be forced inside the four walls, and they would be covered from head to foot. So I think I would end there, and I've exceeded my time. And if there are any questions, I would be happy to answer.
Thank you, Shabnam. I think, you know, no regrets for you exceeding time, because we all were keen to listen to you. And what he was speaking actually was the truth. And many of us are disturbed by, you know, what you have shared. And we are aware of the challenges that, you know, we have faced, we men and women of India are faced with. You know, and I think I don't want to summarize what he said, because I think, you know, it's coming very well to people that how on all frontiers of education, of economy, of workforce, everything, women are going downhill, and how, you know, the current politics is such that, you know, the patriarchal forces are gaining, and it's actually further, you know, imprisoning the women as such. And if there is any gain of the religious forces, the first attack is always on the women. So I think instead of progressing, we are retrogressing. And I think, you know, and I think you did come up with some data in terms of how on education, you know, things improved. But when you talk about the workforce and all, how the women as farmers and as workers have reduced as such, and how with no land rights and all, I think it becomes worse for them. Also, you know, I think you spoke about the experiments that are going about the Garbh Vigyan and all that. And I remember, Shabnam, I think about 2 years back, BHU started a course called Adarsh Bahu. They are going to, you know, talk about socializing the women as Adarsh Bahu. So before getting married, a girl can go for this Adarsh Bahu course and be certified by the Adarsh Bahu course so that anybody who's marrying would know that BHU has done Adarsh Bahu course. Kiya tha. Which means, bilkul achhi grahani ban gaya ye ladki, you know. Docile. Imagine what we...
Docile,
bilkul. Docile and, you know, pliable and, you know, open to all exploitation, everything. You know, I think, Shabnam, you did speak about many things, you know, as to how, you know, Uttam Santati, that the current government or whatever, the approaches are pretty much what Hitler was doing at that point. And, you know, and I think one important thing which you brought up also was that every single social issue has to be seen in its proper connection. So it can't be that the economy shatters and society progresses, or politics goes down and education prospers. I think it's all interconnected, you know. And so I think that's very important. Of course, before the questions come, I surely would want to also ask you in terms like, you know, like when you're talking about women, Shabnam, it's like, you know, especially when you talk about women, it's always the most, you also mentioned about how it's always the most excluded in marginalized sections. Like you spoke about Muslim women, then also about the Dalit women. What happened in Hathras and all these places? Yes. Like when the politicians, Shabnam, Swami Chinmayanand and you know, Kuldeep Singh Sengar and all from this party, political party, which is controlling, which is governing this country, and when they go scot-free, Shabnam, the government tries to protect them and tries to get out these criminals, I think it leaves at a lot of, you know, ill will. And of course, you mentioned about how not just the police, the administration, but judiciary also is crumbling under the current weight of patriarchal forces. And maybe I think when you're answering the question, Shabnam, I would also want you to just share about your current, work you have been doing, say, in Dwarka, the Women's Collective, where you've tried to hold night marches, where you got this sub-inspector arrested for trying to, accost the girls and all. And so, and what your struggle has been, because you said there's an FIR been launched by the Dwarka, you know, police. So maybe if you can also share a bit about the about all this to people, they'll understand your own struggles beyond all this, Shabnam. So I think that's it. But Arjun and Simin, all, if you want to ask some questions, and maybe other participants can also ask questions, then you can take the questions together, Shabnam. Thank you for this fantastic, you know, presentation.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Sir, Professor Govind Kelkar has also joined. Govind, ma'am, if you're here. Ma'am, yes.
Thank you, Shabnam, Hashmi. I have known you since Sardar Patel days when my daughter was your student. So you won't remember her, but we know her.
Mm. No, that was my sister. I never taught in Sardar Patel.
Okay, all right. So that was your sister. I was confusing. Yeah. But ideas remain the same.
Yeah.
So sister and ideas also, besides the kind of being the physical. I don't know really how to add my words of appreciation to your what you have said, because I have been part of the women's movement right from the beginning. And there were serious problems earlier. But then there were also some gains made, as you narrated earlier in this. But in the last 5 years or 4 5 years now, yes, there has been such a come down on which you highlighted. But the most disturbing things are really that a couple of things. One is that, as you know, attacks on women within home and outside, in workplaces, in public streets. One rarely heard, for example, earlier about gang rapes, but now gang rapes are so common. Rape was, of course, there, but and the brutalization of this kind of thing, that is also the kind of destroying, like a commodity that you a child who doesn't know much and he takes in anger a kind of doll and he tears it into kind of pieces. The So human body, woman's body is turned into this kind of thing. So that is one thing. Hathras case proves that, Nirbhaya case proves that, and so many others, they have become the kind of prominent. So attacks on women has become very, very gruesome. That is the, and I am also in one of the advisory capacity, somebody doing work on garment industry, and women are in large numbers of workers there. And kind of abusive language and kind of sexual harassment that these workers go through is amazing. I was surprised being in the kind of thing. That is how the how they have to suffer, those who are working. So that is the workplace situation. Then second factor is also about what we have excelled in production of hate and fundamentalist ideas in all the communities they have been produced, but particularly in the dominant community. The fundamentalist forces and production of hate, production of patriarchal relations, and the toxic masculinity. That is what kind of thing, how the masculine mindset has to force. So if we think that women would be kind of different from them, a lot of thinking, they are really finding them to a kind of support in any corner, and they are not getting it. They are not getting it within family, they are not getting an outside family. But there is a number of labor force decline in the labor force participation, recognized labor force participation. In all our agricultural work is done by women. So they are the food producers. So that has, but they are like workers within their family. They don't have right to own land or do something about the land, own or possess or control land and its produce. I've been doing some work on agriculture. Or on land rights. So we are producing really a generation of docile, dependent, obedient women as the ideal woman of India. That is what about. Of course, I have read the Western history, and that's what the Hitler did, exactly that kind of thing. So you are very right when you say that these forces are leading to that kind of fascist forces. So we are really there, but I was just thinking that what I wanted from you is really, how do we resist this? There are also women who are resisting it at any cost. JNU is an example, lot of individual women are an example, you yourself is an example, then Indira Jai Singh. So women are also not taking it lying down. There is a kind of hope that no matter what kind of thing this is done, our hope lies in resisting this kind of patriarchal, fundamentalist, masculinist norms that are trying to damage us, trying to get rid of us, or trying to eliminate us. I mean, these India and China were known as the kind of economies, very good economies. They have been emerging, and they are still emergent economies in Asia. But both are known for kind of getting rid of the feticide, infanticide, female infanticide, getting. And buying of the women like cattle, because they want women to produce children and work at home and outside. So now they have started buying. So there is a whole marriage market where women are bought like cattle. So this is one thing that that is also there. So wage disparity, no rights on agricultural land, no rights to housing. Where do women go? I mean, completely helpless situation that is there. So, but in all this, I find the hope about those women who are struggling through their writing, who are struggling through their kind of protest, an everyday protest kind of thing. That is what being done. So that would, what did you think that, what would you think about this kind of protest that is the hope of the women against these kind of forces which are trying to completely control them. I don't know, to smash them, not only control them. Mm-hmm. So I think, because there are slogans, not slogans, but there are attempts when they also say that we will smash this patriarchy. So there are kind of a smashing of these forces also. Patriarchy, I'm putting summing up so much kind of thing, where the patriarchy has a lot kind of toxic masculinity. It has the kind of growth we are in, it has the kind of fundamentalist approaches that are being taken, and production of hatred that is being done in the name of the economic growth. What I wanted some words from you with regard to this kind of thing, women's struggle to against this. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Well, I don't think I have a formula or like a magic wand which we should say that do this and things would change. Any social change is a very, very long process, and when we start working on anything, you work with one generation and you will see the results in the next generation, which you might not be able to see, because what Savitri Bai started in 1848, and it has taken hundreds of years for women to get education. There is a lot of resistance, there is no doubt about it. There are huge number of women groups, there are all kinds of very creative things being done. But as I said, that everything is connected to the other. And right now, the kind of political forces that sit in the country, it is not an easy task. It does not mean that the resistance won't be there, but it is not an easy task. It has to be fought at every levels. When we talk of patriarchy and gender equality, I always say that, it has to begin from within the home. And every woman who feels stifled, who feels that she's not being treated equally, she has to start from her own house. Have that courage to start from there. But unless there are changes at the structural level, it is not an easy task to turn the tables. It's a slow process. We'll keep on fighting, but we have to keep on devising new methods. I would just share with you, it was in July, beginning of July, that just 2-3 of us discussed an idea of doing something, and it was pandemic, and even this, the amount of, people who are going out today, even at that time, it was much, much less. So we thought of doing an online campaign, which we called If We Do Not Rise, Hum Agar Uthe Nahi Toh. And from July to, we did a one-day campaign on 5th September. From first week of July till 5th September, we had 28 states participating in it. 28 states had formed their own groups, had done discussions. And we ended up having 3,000 programs on the ground, actual programs, and the social media campaign had 15 lakh people participate. I mean, who witnessed it, not everyone who either saw it or shared it or posted something. So that was huge, and which conveyed that people are quite fed up. Also, the other hope which I feel very positive about is the under 25 generation. Because the under 25 is revolting. And I really don't know whether that's happening in rural India, but in urban India, you see a lot of that. The parents are conservative, parents are very patriarchal, parents are also politically very right-wing, but the children are protesting. And they are not ready to be controlled by them. And this under 25 generation is not carrying the baggage of caste, is not carrying the baggage of being communal. So there is a lot of hope there. And we have seen them. I mean, we have seen them during the GNU struggle. We have seen them during the anti-NRC, anti-CEA protest. Of course, the fascist government is doing all it can to curb all this dissent. And they will continue to do that. They will continue to ensure that more and more people who are vocal, they stop speaking, or they are jailed, or they are killed, or whatever. But I think this struggle will continue. And it is not hopeless totally. I still feel that, what we have seen in Bihar, the kind of rallies, and I'm not going into the results because this is not the forum to discuss that. But I believe that it would have been a total victory for the secular forces. So it is not that the things are hopeless, but it's a long struggle. It's not going to be ending in one or two days. Achha, Indu, there are a number of questions in the chat box.
Yes, I'm taking up the questions, Shabnam. I'll read out the questions to you. Oh. And then maybe, you know, we can just have the answers for that. Okay.
Some of them quite similar, I think. So you can...
Yeah. I think there's one, that can you speak of the current situation, some more of persons called internally displaced post-genocide 2002. Anand had done a report several years ago as well on the state of resettlement colonies for displaced. Can you share from your view what is the situation now? Have any persons been able to return back to the older communities? It has been noticed in some contexts that Dalit and tribal community members participated in the violence against Muslim persons in 2002 Gujarat. In that economy of violence, either falsely implicated or prepared in a sense, if you can speak more on that. Also in one place, it was stated in oral sharings in great fear that some Congress Party MLAs were seen directing some mobs that engaged in violence in Gujarat, genocide 2002. And because no one was willing to speak on record, those narratives were perhaps bleeped out from mainstream discourses. What is the response to any such comments, rumors, etc.? And there is still a political economy where the right wing is criticized, but often the genocide survivors and the need for them to have justice in whatever ways they choose to is forgotten almost by mainstream. Why do you think that is that? There is an economy where an anti-right-wing policies is stated and practiced, but rights of genocide survivors of 2002 Gujarat still stay denied. They're silenced or in the background now. Sometimes ago, a caravan was being taken out perhaps for communal harmony by women's collectives. And there had been a tie-up with UN Women, and then a withdrawal of that collaboration happened, and it was shared perhaps that there was some political last-minute pressure from that being done. Would you wish to speak about that from your perspective, UN and its policies? Is it pro-rights or pro-existing political privileged economy? Yeah, that's the Shabnam. And then I think, yeah, there was an instance from many years ago. It was alleged that in Gujarat, the polling booth was within an RSS VHP Shaka, and members of the Muslim community there at time feeling vulnerable were fearing to even go and make a vote for fear of life. So what kind of policy do you suggest for voter safety in genocide, post-genocide context? Any views? Yeah.
Definitely somebody who's following Anhad very closely.
Yes, I know. Yeah.
Well, I have not been to Gujarat for a few years now. There was a time when I was in Gujarat for years together. And it is not because of any apathy. It is just, one is that, I mean, before I start answering, I think it is very important to understand that activists or of all kinds, they are human beings. Because many a times the expectations from activists are that they can do everything. They can't. You are, according to my knowledge of the last, which is 2 years old, majority of the internally displaced in Gujarat were not able to go back. They were the last survey that we did was, which Anhad did the last survey was in 2007, but Janvikas had done a survey after that, around 2012. And till then, there were about 5,000 families which had not returned to their villages because it was just not possible to return. If you remember in 2002, after the genocide, there were villages after villages, hundreds of them, which had put boards outside saying, this is welcome to the Hindu Rashtra of such and such village. And it said that, these are sanitized villages, there are no Muslims. So they could never go back. And the conditions were pathetic. They continue to be pathetic. There was one that the government did not make any relief colonies. It was all done by either by the NGOs or by the Muslim groups. And even from the Muslim groups, there were a lot of problems because none of them transferred the land in the name of the internally displaced. They kept it with them. So all those problems were there. Also, these colonies were quite far away from the main cities. So as a result, it affected the children's education, and there were hardly any health facilities, and the basic sanitation, all those were quite a lot of problems at that time. But as I said, that last two and a half years, I have not been there. So if there has been any change, I might not know, but if you are from Gujarat, you would know Janvikas. Janvikas has been very actively working with the internally displaced, and you can talk to them. Yes, Dalit and tribal communities were involved in 2002, but according to our information, whatever we did on the ground, they were involved mainly in the looting, not in killing people, not in raping. Maybe a few, but majority of those who killed and raped was the right-wing, you know, totally right-wing cadre. Because if now that we are talking about it, I'm suddenly reminded, you know, I had documented about 50 cases of women who were survivors and they were gang raped. And everywhere I heard the similar fashion in which women were gang raped, or the it was the same way in which houses were burned. So it was a very organized way of the attack. And, you know, you can, when you talk of Kausar Bano, you can think of that maybe there was some maniac who did that. But when you hear several cases like hers, and you when you are shown photographs of women after women whose womb is, cut open, and you can see the unborn child on a burned body, you realize that it was not just one person who did that. It was probably, there were people who were taught to violate women's bodies in a certain way. And to our knowledge, most of the Dalits and tribals were not involved in that. In fact, much later when I went again to many of those villages, many people told me that our tribal neighbors came and returned a lot of things. And they said that, you know, we were forced to do this, and we were also threatened many times, and we also, many of them also got carried away. But yes, that is what I can tell you about this. About the Congress MLA, no, I don't know of this incident, but there was, what I heard was that a person who was with one of the Congress, it was either NSUI or Youth Congress, he was seen as part of the mob attacking. That was told to me directly also. So I don't know about who heard what, but that is something which I have heard myself and from a number of people. And in fact, because I'm a social activist, I interact with politicians from almost all political parties except the right wing. So I had raised this and told them that this is the man who, I had all those details at that time. So I had passed them on to the Congress.
Ma'am, you can choose to answer, not...
No, this is fine.
Okay.
Genocide survivors need to have justice. Well, yes, you are right. Genocide survivors need to have justice, and... because it was, so huge, the whole scale was so huge that it was humanly impossible to reach out to everyone. And as you know, that in the very beginning, most of the cases were shut down. And then Harsh Bandar went to Supreme Court, reopened, got the cases reopened. Even after that, half of them got shut down. And, you know, only one case of Bilkis Bano, where conviction was done in the rape case. It was Janvikas and Gagan Sethi who was working on that case for years together. So fighting one case, it requires the kind of intensity, the kind of time, commitment, conviction, and money. So it is humanly impossible for just individual organizations or voluntary organizations. It is the state's responsibility. But when the state is against you, and when the state is the perpetrator, then this is what happens. There were a large number of organizations which came, which did relief, rehabilitation. At that time, it was done. But once you are uprooted, once you lose everything, it is very difficult to go back to the original position. And even mentally, even if you are financially, even if you reach back, mentally what scars you for life. I mean, I remember we had brought 25 kids from Gujarat, from Kalol. There's this rehabilitation colony there. They were with us. We were running a center, and the children used to go to school. The first few months were terrible because those children would get up at night and start shouting. They used to get nightmares. So it required a lot of counseling and help from, you know, professionals to deal with those kids. Now they're all grown up, they're married. But it's a humongous task, which one or two or even 100 organizations can't do. And secondly, every single day now, I mean, that was many people, a large number of people had engaged with Gujarat. But now every week there is a new attack. So it is becoming impossible to respond to every single thing. And the way things are being normalized, you know, every single day you find that so-and-so has been arrested. There's this case, there's that case. People are being attacked. People are being killed. There are gang rapes. There are people being lynched. So beyond a point, you can, you know, somebody asked me, why didn't you go to such and such place? A rape has happened. So there are 88 rapes happening every day. That was on a press conference that we did after our visit to Hathras. We had gone to Annie Raja, myself, and Poonam Kaushik had gone to Hathras. So, I mean, how do you physically do that? Booth, yes, I also remember, Ajahn, this question in between about this campaign was called Baatein Aman Ki. And yes, this happened. You are very right that UN Women had told us that they would provide us 5 vehicles. We had gone on, there were 5 groups of people, women, 25 each. And we traveled from 5 corners of India and stopped at 200 places. This campaign was around safeguarding the constitution, but we spoke about gender equality and everything. A month-long campaign where we started from Kerala, Assam, Delhi, Tamil Nadu, and Kashmir, and culminated in Delhi. So it was just, frankly, it was 3 days before we were to start that UN Women withdrew that support. And only we know how we managed it, because it was not possible to cancel. In 200 cities, there were, you know, committees formed, program venues blocked and paid for. There were over 500 programs, rallies and cultural events. There were huge campaign. And 3 days before that, there was no way we could have canceled it. So last moment, we took loans and we decided to go ahead. But I must say that after it was over and we gave a call that, you know, we need to repay this loan, we collected the funds. Of course, NFIW, which was part of the campaign, also donated a large amount of that loan. But we were able to collect that amount and return it. It was only because of ordinary people's support that, you know, we were able to do that campaign. So yes, there must have been political pressure. There is no other way that, although they said there is no political pressure, but there was pressure on their Bangkok office. And that must, and I mean, people who are into this business know it, that the pressure comes only from one place or two places. There are these two men, either one office or the other office.
That's true.
Directly. There is no third party involved in that. So it is either the PMO or the Home Ministry, which calls people and tells them to do certain things. The last question is about the polling booth being in a place. Yes, it is true that had happened, and the question was raised. Well, the polling booths have to be near, especially when there is insecurity. It has to be where the people live. It has to be within 200 meters of the place where people live. And at that point, we had taken up these issues. I don't exactly remember. I mean, I had personally met the election commissioners and on many other things also. I mean, one of the things on which I have met the election commissioners many times over are the EVMs, because we strongly feel that EVMs are being manipulated. So we did that. And yes, all your questions are, I think I've answered all the questions, unless there is something else now.
Let me add few things based on your special talk, ma'am. Thank you very much for finding out time from your busy schedule and really talking about this very pertinent issue on our special gender gap series on this topic of women rights in 21st century India from the lens of a social activist. Ma'am, you have really started from mentioning Savitribai Phule and how the education has been in the last century so tough that even the participation in education, in knowledge, basic knowledge, and then in all spheres of life. And ma'am has really quoted and highlighted employment statistics from the last decade and then raised many points, especially pertaining to the employment scenario, be it participation, lower level of participation, pay gap, abuses, so many different things, and really highlighting that the market is not playing its part and having the gender gaps per se. One thing really I'm highlighted, which I really wanted to focus on for the sake of this talk, that ma'am really highlighted all the fight towards political reservation. What ma'am, we have been also, our chairperson, Professor Govind, has also been highlighted that the right to property is very important, right to land. And as an economist or as the idea or, you know, impact policy, what we also see from also all the developed regions of the world also, that the participation of women is very essential, not just, you know, the dummy given. That takes a lot of time. So real participation in all the, I would say, the society, economy, and all the spheres. Ma'am, what do you think and what do you, how do you see this political reservation, one third? I think that can also be a good a signaling message that should be taken. What are the roadblocks? Every time we hear, last time also we heard before the election, something happening, a chairperson of AICC also writing letters. That has been, I think, I've been studying in JNU in last decade. And since then we have been hearing, really, ma'am, what is your view as a social activist? I'll just add a few more points. And ma'am has really highlighted all the like gang rape and so many things. Ma'am is really highlighting in one day, 88, more than 100 cases, the deterioration of story and what we are being highlighted as India in world media is something very deplorable. We are breaking records of all its kind in Kerala, ambulance taking a woman affected by corona and compounder doing the rape. And, you know, doctor doing the operation, that is not getting end. Ma'am, what do you think as your experience and so much of also fight with in terms of legal, political, so many spheres you deal with, how to come over, especially in this 21st century, from this institutionalized, social deep-rooted mindset, how to fight this. And really now, ma'am has highlighted that as the times are changing, this patriarchal and but now also the majoritarian imposement and the business as usual scenario is will perhaps increase this gap, gender gap, and would not lead to equality, liberty, fraternity, what our constitution has enshrined. Ma'am, really, one last point I wanted to make. What are the small steps which communities or, you know, government, a group of people should take, and also researchers like us, practitioners, to embed in themselves to have small steps or, you know, bigger steps which will have impact. And the policies really, Nirbhaya Fund, and so many things of so many of struggle of so many people, but really nothing in implementation. So you have all the fund, everything, gender responsive budgeting, this, that, so many legal document fighting court, Indusar fights a lot. But then when it is coming to implementation here, there, you know, again, the business as usual scenario this bureaucracy is also leading to somewhat business as usual and accentuating this gender gap. So I have a few more things. I think you have understood the crux what the policies and what steps should be to have an impact and towards narrowing this gap, and how we can learn from your this deep, vast experience. And how do you get so much of, I would say, strength to keep doing this even at this age? Yes, thank you, ma'am, so much.
No, I'm young. What do you mean even at this age?
Yes.
I'm only 63. Now the average age is, I think, 75 or something in India. When we were children, the average age was much lower. So... 33% reservation.
But ma'am, let me just add, since you mentioned this very pertinent point, and now the employment figures, as India being one of the youngest country in the age or this number, demographic dividend, in terms of unemployment, the graduate girls, 50-60% unemployment rate. You pass the college, there is no job, also for boys, but that level is so huge. And this is propping up, and our youth is becoming, you also said that, but there is also hope, a silver lining. And especially I have witnessed all through my studies from Jamia, JNU, everywhere, people also with their parents and, guide teachers like you, we are going forward and taking those steps. Sorry to, again, but I really thought to make this point. Yes, ma'am, 33% reservation.
So, 33 was when we started fighting about it. A generation before me, frankly. We are 30. The struggle for political participation of women became, I think it was Geeta Mukherjee of the CPI who first started talking about it in the parliament. We are the next generation after her who started this struggle. According to me, the major roadblock are the men in political parties and patriarchal mindset. Because while in every time it is said that, it was passed in one house and it was not passed in the second house. So it was, I won't name the political leader, but a very senior political leader had told me that I don't have support within my own party because the men do not want to leave their seats. So it is not that, what is reflected in the parliament, sometimes one political party would oppose, sometimes the other would oppose. But in principle, it is within the political parties, the fact that men are totally controlling political parties, even if the person who's leading the party is a woman, even then it is controlled by majority men. And they do not want to, because if political parties are so serious about giving space to women, then where are the women in their political parties? I'm saying parliament and assembly will come later. First, they have to be there in the central committee, in the Politburo, in the whatever, different political parties have different setups, their secretariats. You don't see women leadership within the political parties. How many women are there in, say, how many women are general secretaries of Congress? Look at the percentage. Is it 33%? It should be 50%. How many women are in the Politburo of CPM? How many women are there in CPI, in, I think, whatever it is called, their Politburo or whatever they call it? So unless political parties are serious about it, giving that space to women within, at every level, it was because there was reservation in panchayat and gram sabha level. That is why we see so many women there. Otherwise, in parliament, we have, I think, 12 or 14% women. And India must be one of, all other South Asian countries have a lot more women. So unless, again, it goes back to the same thing, same patriarchy, same anti-women attitudes, same right wing. And that mindset is in all the parties. What about, forget all these parties. What about Aam Aadmi Party?
Yes.
Which came with all those promises.
Yes.
In the first time they had one women MLA, Alka Lamba, She was not given any position. Even the Ministry of Women and Child Welfare, even that is run by a man. And okay, you even if we say that, oh, Alka Lama was from the Congress and they didn't want to risk that. I mean, what about Atishi? Why Atishi was not given a ministership? She won her election. Or even if she had lost, they could have given her a... So there is no space. I mean, people who are running these parties are highly patriarchal and they don't want to give any space to women. So this again, I mean, this has to be fought by women and by men who are feminist men who believe in equality. These are very, very difficult fights. And I don't see this happening at all. Because with the present political dispensation, we don't see anything progressing. We are only, as I said, I have said it so many times that we are going backwards. That was one thing. What was the rape? Well, you see, it is not that violence against women has not happened. It has been happening forever. And it was after Nirbhaya that we, you know, the Verma committee was set up and they were the finest of our feminist lawyers who worked there, Indra Jaisingh and Vrinda Grover and many, many others. So the law which they have made is very good, except that it still does not recognize marital rape. Everything otherwise, it's a good law. But only having good laws, we have good laws on many things. We have an anti-sati law, we have an anti-dowry law, we have so many laws which are in favor of women. But unless the implementation is there, unless the person who is sitting there, whether it is in police or judiciary, unless those minds are gender sensitive, there is no way that we are ever going to get convictions. And on the other hand, unless we are bringing up our sons, I mean, when I say our, I'm saying the nation's sons, unless we are bringing them up as nice, humane human beings who have empathy, unless that happens, and we don't see that happening. When at the political level, you are constantly propagating violence, you are constantly degrading women, you are constantly, for example, this, when you have these kind of mindsets, it is very difficult to change the situation. The resistance will remain there. And I mean, I'm not saying that if you remove this government, then suddenly everything will become better. As I said, there were rapes earlier, there were attacks earlier, but in the last 5-6 years, they have gone up many folds. The violence against women has gone up by 5-6% only in 1 year. And rape as a tool is being used now. If you look at the pattern of any kind of violence, you see, if we say it happens on its own, no, it doesn't. It is planned. When lynching in the name of cow happens in one place, within that month, you will see lynchings across India. When a gang rape happens, you will see gang rapes happening across India. So there is a system to what is happening. And rape is being used as a tool to subjugate women, especially of the Dalit community, of the Muslim community, or anyone who raises their voices. So when you have this kind of politics, we can keep on fighting, we can keep on raising our voices. But unless we are able to change the political system, it might reduce, it might become bigger, but it won't be solved. I mean, we're talking about policy level. Well, Mr. Modi, who is a very good, as I say, an event manager, because he announces schemes and which are covered by the controlled media. And it looks as if, everything is shining in this country. Beti padhao, beti bachao. 65% of that budget has been used for advertisements. So even if you bring a good policy, even if we consider that it's a good policy, if you are using 65% of that budget for projecting your own face on every television and newspaper, then what is the point? Where is that money going? And rest of the 35% has not been utilized fully. So as I said, that everything is connected. Only bringing policies is not going to change. It's a very long struggle, and it has become much longer, because we have lost on scientific temper, we have lost on rationality, we have lost on humanity, we have lost on love and peace. And today we have people sitting in the government who are anti-science, who are anti-rationality, who are anti-women, who are anti any kind of peace and communal harmony. So first challenge is to remove them, which is again not an easy task.
Thank you, ma'am.
Small steps are many, but for young people, especially the young people, the most important step is fall in love. And fall in love, I mean, it is not in your hand whom you will fall in love with. But if you go in for inter-religious and inter-caste marriages, that might bring some harmony in this country and might bring some kind of sensibilities. Because when different communities, when different religions, when people of different caste meet each other, only then they realize that the other is not a devil. You see, what they have done, they have ghettoized totally. There are many people, you will find many people in places like Gujarat who would have never seen a Muslim, and the Muslims who have never seen a Hindu. So when you don't meet each other, it is so easy to put hatred into your minds. When you meet the other community, when you meet the other caste, when you meet the other linguistic community, or when you meet a person who has a different sexual orientation, when you meet them, when you talk to them, only then you would come to know, you know, about them. And inter-caste, inter-religious marriages are extremely important to happen. And I think Ambedkar had said it at that time, that if you do that, half your problems of this hatred and prejudices against each other would vanish.
Yes. Thank you, ma'am. I really visited United States, and there I got a chance to read the writing of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. There I really got this idea, which you just rightly mentioned, that inter-caste marriage is something that can really yield to many things. And ma'am, one last point I really wanted to mention, that in other South Asian countries, Bangladesh, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, like we have Raj Sabha, the permanent seat, there half, one third of the seats are reserved for women. So no matter what the parliament would be, there are always women on the upper house.
Yes.
We do not have that scenario. So at least upper house has that sensitivity, and some successes have come from Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, not so much, of course, but how should we envisage now this political process when in planning, in leadership, there are no position for women? I would say there is a lot of competition. Then how the implementation would be done, because everything is so much linked. So ma'am, what do you think that political process should be? Where should the researchers and practitioners should focus upon? This political reservation really have so much of backlog now that we need to have 75% reservation now for like 10, 20 years, then that backlog will, you know, something useful can happen. I also really had a good chance to meet Justice Verma when he came out with his report. And then also he was very hopeful that, you know, many things will turn around, and it's good that the leadership is taking very much interest. But then he passed away. We don't know that whether what he envisaged so quickly by then, and we are now in 2020, so many years passed and nothing is happening. And rationality, scientific temper, so many good takeaway from your special talk today, ma'am. One last thing, really, that the women empowerment or gender gaps or whatever things we are raising today, what is it? Is it a demand? Is it a right? It is a human right. Is it a woman empowerment? Which space? Because the space which we are fighting for, essentially and in principle, from which angle we should take it, especially for this long march and your experience as social activist. Indra sir, if you'd like to add anything.
Let Shamna speak and then towards the end I'll add something. Yeah, sure.
Rights are human rights. I mean, I don't like the word empowerment. Probably because, I mean, it's a good word. I'm not saying it's a bad word, but probably the way it is used in India, women empowerment, which actually doesn't empower women.
I mean, like Ujwala. Ujwala and toilet. Huh?
Yes. Women empowerment is you build a toilet and you build most of those toilets which are built are dry toilets. And and majority of the manual scavengers are women, which in principle has been abolished, but in practice it exists. So this kind of empowerment, we have to fight from the perspective of rights, women's rights, human rights. That's the only perspective from which we can write. And about your earlier question, I don't have answers to every question. How to go about the 33% reservation now. It's a very, very difficult situation. And as I said, we are going... I think what researchers need to do is to study what makes a fascist mind. What are the processes which are turning... That's my dog barking. What are the processes which are turning good, humane minds? Because nobody is born with a fascist mind. Nobody is born... And then find ways of countering that. Because unless we are able to fight this mindset, I mean, our national consciousness has shifted so drastically from being, humane and nice and gentle and inviting everyone, accepting everyone within your home to being so bigoted. I mean, I'm actually, when you look back at your childhood and you talk to people around you now, especially the place where I live in Dwarka, which is a middle upper middle class colony and a right wing colony, it's actually, I mean, no logic goes inside. It looks as if there is kind of a kavach sar pe, uske andar koi window nahi hai jisse aap koi logic andar bhej. They are like what we call bhakts, and no amount of any argument will ever make any change. So it's a very, very slow process. And they have done it over 30, 40 years, not in one day. The slow poisoning of the minds where instead of being a compassionate human being, you become a bigot. That process is very dangerous. And it's not going to be easy to, to change it. We can save our younger people from it and continue to fight. Energy comes from the conviction that we must not leave a country when we die in this shape. We must have at least of what we were in 70s, 80s, at least we should take it back to that position, and then the next generation can do what they want.
Yeah. Thank you, Shabnam. I just want to know, I think from the answers that he gave, I just have the three things to just say here, that, and to also share with other friends who are there, that, I've also mentioned that in my fifth book called City Makers, that, from the lens of the homeless people that I've been working for the last 20 years, Shabnam, which I think you're also part of it, you understand the work we have done, because we've engaged at various levels, together on those issues, that there are two Indias, not the Indian Bharat, but the India, which all capital letters, where everything works. Constitution of India, Adani Ambani's and Parliament, Constitution, everything works there, Shabnam. The problem is with the other India, which is actually all lowercase non-India, Shabnam, where the Dalits and the Muslims and tribals and the women and children all languish and suffer, where nothing works.
And the homeless.
Nothing works at all, Shabnam. So it's that, if we are able to realize that actually you're talking of non-India, and we need to assert for the rights of this non-India into the Constitution of India, I think is what maybe we require to be more political about and assert for the rights of people, which I think many of you are doing actually, Shabnam, through various mobilizations that you're doing. Second, I also want to add here to friends, that in this 30% reservation, I don't know whether Shabnam remembers that. In fact, when we were all active in that, when there was a delegation going to meet the president, that time it was Pratibha Patil who was the president, and I remember the day, Shabnam, 29 July 2010, And there was a delegation in which there were 10 people going. And Shabnam kept herself out and she put this one man that was me in the delegation. So that's Shabnam Hashmi, you know, who can keep herself out from such, you know, public faces. She has been working silently at times. But thank you, Shabnam, for that, you know, where you actually are inclusive. You include people into movements and mobilizations, which is what makes, and I was the only man in that entire women's delegation. And I remember telling Pratibha Patilji, ki, ma'am, actually 33% reservation to bahut kam hai. Ye 50% hona chahiye. So she said, "Arey 30% mein to nahi hone de rahe log jo hai 50 mangenge to kuch nahi hone wala hai." I said, "Ma'am, koi baat nahi. As the president, aap kahiye to sahi. Aap kam se kam jo hai." So I think that was I want to share here publicly that is, I want to acknowledge the support that you have been giving Shabnam to a large number of people and movements and all. And third is, I would not want to close this discussion before you discuss about what you've done in Dwarka. I think because that's interesting, you know, one part of the city which is so patriarchal, which is anti-women, where Nirbhaya happens, where so much of sexual assault and rape and all, Delhi happens to be the rape capital of the country. What is it that you are doing through Dwarka Women's Collective, and which is so important, you know? You've had a meeting today also, and you've been doing this for the last couple of years. So please do share that, because I think, Shabnam, we would want to know this.
Just give me one second. My dog is troubling.
No, let him have his voice also, Shabnam. He needs his voice as well. Usko bolne do. Usko bhokne do, Shabnam. Unki right hai. Mere abhi kutta hai, woh bhokta hai. Rehne do usko. Koi nahi bhokne do. Doesn't disturb us, Shabnam.
Especially include, be included.
He's jumping on me.
Okay, ma'am. What also local communities can also learn from your localized efforts, which you have been doing.
Yes.
So, you know, we have been living in Dwarka. I came here in 2007, so quite a few years. And we have done various things here. But what happened recently, on 17th of, actually on 20th, on one of the Dwarka groups, someone sent me a video. And that was of a young girl called Shirin Talwar, where she was narrating what happened to her on 17th October morning. And it was, she was cycling in the morning when a man in a bolero, not bolero, whatever car, gray color and with no number plate, he harassed her and he flashed at her. So she had, you know, she was petrified. She somehow managed to escape. And then she called the police and whatever happened. But she decided to do this video because she felt that unless I do this video, I won't be at peace with my own self and I must take it up. They went to the police. Initially, the police said, ki wo to ab tak bhaag gaya hoga, wo to jaake apni, he will get a number plate changed and, you know, how do we find him and all that. So we saw this video on 20th and immediately then got in touch with some of the women who have been active with us on various things. And we called a meeting on 21st night, a Zoom meeting. And meanwhile, one of the women who's active with us, her daughter and this girl had studied together. So she connected with Shirin and she also joined the meeting. And we decided that we must take this up. So next day we took an appointment with the DCP. We went and met him. And we gave it in writing, a very strong memorandum, and asking them to act upon it. And on next day, then first we met the DCP, and then the next day we met the district magistrate with all these demands. Meanwhile, Shirin started getting messages from innumerable girls that this has happened to us also, this has happened to me, this has happened to me, this has happened to me. And there were at least three girls who had put it on various Instagram, Facebook about same man, same car, same incident. On 17th morning, same road, three incidents had taken place on the same road between 6:30 and 8:40 p.m. And now we know as of now that there is a case against him in 2018 and one in 2019. And then January this year, there are several cases. And then, you know, after we went and met and we also did a press conference, etc., finally he was arrested. And I was told late night on, I think it was 24th or 25th of October, that he has been arrested and he is a police inspector, sub-inspector, and the police might not release the name release it, because he is from their force. So again, we had to do some, I didn't want to give any statement unless I knew 100% that this is the case. So I messaged a few people and we were told that, yes, he has been arrested. Anyway, the next day police announced he was arrested. He's still in Tihar jail. So around this and the whole apathy of the administration, in this case, at least they have arrested him. But the fact that he has been there since 2018, and 2018 case is pretty bad when he has even assaulted not sexually, but otherwise assaulted the girl. And he was getting, getting away every time. So we also took it up. We said, you have to take action against traffic police, because if a car is traveling if I go outside in a car which doesn't have a number, I'll be caught in 10 minutes in Dwarka. There are so many barricades, there are CCTV cameras. But from January till October, this man has been going around of what we knew that day. Now we know that 2018, it is the same car and the same man who has been doing this. So, and the traffic police doesn't nab him. In the 2018 case, he came back after hitting this girl. And by then she had called the PCR. And the PCR also did not catch him. They said, we couldn't, he got away. So we realized that he has some clout within the police. And we have been demanding that you find out who are the moles in your system, but which the police is just refusing. Meanwhile, what has happened? He was the PA of the DCP traffic. And when this DCP was with PCR, at that time also, this person was his PA. Which means that they have worked together, not only as traffic, but also in PCR. I mean, they're two different posts, DCP traffic and DCP PCR. And last week, this DCP has been transferred to Dwarka as the additional DCP of Dwarka. And our additional DCP has been transferred out. So now we have written to the Lieutenant Governor that, how do we tell ourselves that the inquiry would be objective if you have sent his boss who has been working under him, and he has been doing all these cases all these years. How do we know that the charge sheet has not been filed as yet? So we are demanding that it should be rolled back. So far it has not been done. But anyway, meanwhile, we have formed this Dwarka Women's Collective, which we launched today, which we announced today. And we plan to, one, to tell the women here that if you feel afraid, if you are alone, we are there. It is not that we can do a lot, because all of us, everyone who is in Dwarka Women's Collective, are also very busy women in their own lives and their own work. So, but whatever we can do to provide this kind of support, going and meeting higher officials, taking it up, we will keep on doing it, and we will provide. Plus, we have proposed that we would be doing gender sensitization trainings in Dwarka for the people of Dwarka. If the police is ready, we have said it publicly. We have told them we are happy to do these trainings for your cadre, your force, and we are happy to do these trainings for administration, anyone. So we plan to do that. We plan to do campaigns around gender sensitivity. Whoever is ready for that in Dwarka, we would be trying to do. Also, we want to take up the whole question of the Dwarka roads, which are totally empty. The way Dwarka is built, there are footpaths, but there is nobody on the roads. So if there are no vehicles on the road, it's empty. We are also taking up the issue of the dark spots, CCTVs not being there, but also this sensitization for prevention. And what we are proposing, that we want to have, a situation where you give kiosks on various roads so that there is at least somebody there. And if possible, something like the Delhi Heart, open a Dwarka Heart in various places. Have these various sets of shops on every road which gets deserted. So that you don't feel, insecure when you are walking on these roads. So these are some of the things which we are going to take up and plan to do.
Mm. And Shabnam, why has the police filed the FIR against you now?
Oh, yes. So yeah. After, I forgot that. After, yeah. After we met the, I mean, on 22nd, we had met the DCP. At that time itself, we had decided that we will take out a women's march for safe public spaces. And we gave him an application and he was very positive. Next day, we gave an application to also the, since we were meeting the district magistrate, we also gave him one. And then on 28th, we had slightly changed the route. So we gave another application saying that we have changed the spot from where we are beginning. 29th, as you know, police never gives anything in writing. They give you verbally, go ahead, for these permissions are never given. We invited the DCP to speak. We also invited the district magistrate and the DLSA judge. She had confirmed, DCP had confirmed that I'll come and speak at the culmination of the program. Meanwhile, DCP got COVID and he was in hospital. Anyway, so my other women from the collective, they met the additional DCP and gave him the letter asking, because we wanted that the police has arrested the man and we must appreciate that. And we wanted to provide a platform where some kind of collaboration between the police and the citizens can begin. And also Dwarka citizens should be assured that, you know, we are taking these steps and we are with you from the police side, that we are going to be, you know, with you and we can work together. But on 31st, just 2 hours before the program, I was finalizing something, probably doing the press release or something, when a volunteer called from where the program had to culminate. And he said, the police has come here and they are saying you don't have permission. And meanwhile, Seema Joshi, another woman from Dwarka, an activist, she got a call from the police, ki aapki permission nahi hai, aap ye nahi kar sakte. So anyway, we rushed to the culmination point, which is outside DDA complex, sports complex. And the policemen were there. And they said, aapki permission nahi. And I said, but you know, because I had got a call on 30th at 8:15 p.m. from SI Vikas Yadav. And he asked me, he said, madam, aapka route kya hai? Kahan se shuru karenge? Kahan khatam karenge? Kis time shuru hogi? Kab khatam hogi? Which is a regular thing. When you are doing something, always you get 4 or 5 calls. And kitni der chalegi. So I told him ki hum 3:30 shuru karenge. 3:30 ka time diya, 4 baje shuru karenge. We will reach the venue by 4:30. Aur 1.5-2 ghante ka program hai, to 7 baje humne likha hai, lekin hum 6:30 tak hi wind up kar denge. Usse der se nahi chalega. So he said, just ensure ki COVID ka. Maine kaha wo humne bahut logon ko mobilize kiya nahi hai, because 100 se zyada ki permission nahi hai. So there won't be more than 100 people. And we have enough volunteers who would maintain distance and everything. So this was done. Now, when this Vikas Yadav appeared here, before him, there were some other people. And he said, permission nahi hai. I said, but kal to aapse baat hui hai. To aapne kal kyun nahi kaha? You know, you could have told me yesterday. I spoke to the DCP at around 6:15 p.m. We were, women were, you know, practicing in a park. They were doing a, performing on a song. So from there, I called the DCP and I said, you know, I wish you best of health and I know you are in hospital and COVID. So please, could you let me know who will come from the police to speak at the program? So he said, you get in touch with the additional DCP. I said, fine. Already Seema has been in touch with him, so I don't need to. So because there was no point, she has already spoken to him. This is at 6:15. 8:15 is the SI. And next day, just 2 hours before, so they came here. They said, no, wo tent wale ko kaha, apna saman uthao jao yahan se, sound and everything, because we had arranged everything. We had got, in fact, good sound because we wanted, because there were performances and all that. So they said, no, we will not allow you this. Then he said, aap 5 minute rukiye. He kept on calling people this and that. He said, nahi, hum aapko allow nahi kar sakte. So anyway, we sent back the tent and everything from there, from the culmination point. And then we decided, because I mean, people didn't know it has been cancelled. So we said we will go to the place from where the march has to start, because wahan to mahilaen to wahan pahunchengi sari. So we went there and slowly people came. I mean, we had not done a huge campaign and there were actually people who were in touch with police, because there are enough people who are police chamchas. They also called people to say ki cancel ho gaya. before even we knew. They had called people to say ki cancel ho gaya, jana mat. Anyway, so there were about, I think about 60, 65 people or 70 people who gathered. So then we decided, we did the, you know, the culmination program at the beginning. And then we, and meanwhile, this same Yadav, Vikas Yadav, he said, aap march nikal lijiye, humne police bula li hai aapki safety ke liye. He also said ki yahan agar aapko koi gadbad banda mile, to aap hume bata dijiyega jo aapke saath na ho, taki koi problem na ho. So we said, fine. And we took out a march. And 3 days ago, I was in Delhi University, Tuesday, Monday. Yeah, last month. This Monday or Tuesday, I don't remember. So Gohar called me up. He said, there is a notice for you. They have filed an FIR against you under flouting this COVID rules and all that. So that's it. They have sent a notice to me and to Seema, both of us. So we went there today. We went there today. The young SI woman, she was not interested in listening anything. She just kept saying, aapke paas permission nahi thi, aapne bheed jama kar li. I said, there was no bheed. There was no bheed. 60 people is not a bheed. You know, you should have told us earlier that we... Then he said, theek hai, aap court mein aap batayega jo bhi batana hai. I mean, she was not interested in knowing anything. कोर्ट में बताइएगा इनका अगर कोर्ट में ही मिलना था तो आप कह देते फिर कोर्ट में ही बात करते फिर यहां भी क्यों बुलाया गिव अस द नेम्स ऑफ ऑल दोज हु अटेंडेड सिर्फ वो पब्लिक प्रोग्राम है हम कोई अटेंडेंस थोड़ी लगा रहे हैं और ना हमारा ये काम है आप तो वहां थे सीमा सेठ आप तो वहां थी आप खुद देख लेती कोई हमारा थोड़ी काम है आप पुलिस बना के देंगे कौन आया था कौन नहीं सो दैट इज वेयर इट इज इट्स आई मीन एज फार एज आई अंडरस्टैंड इट इज जस्ट सिंपल इंटिमिडेशन
Because
for two and a half years, this man was not arrested. He was just, you know, getting away from all those cases. Now that he has been arrested, and also I think our writing a letter to the LG has angered them to some level. So it's just sheer intimidation. If for standing with, you know, with young girls who have been harassed, if for that they want to arrest us, it's fine. I have no problem.
No, I think this is sheer harassment, Shabnam. And, you know, I think we all are together in this. I think anytime you require our support, we are there for that. And I think I'm glad that you all fought and got this chap arrested. Yeah.
Also, we have got photographs of a rally which was organized by the district magistrate where one banner which says, Ek meter ki duri bana ke rakhiye. And there are 5 people holding that banner and standing, you know, next to each other. And it's a small banner. So it is not that they're stopping every rally.
Absolutely.
And there was this, you know, why the COVID is not applied there? Why the COVID is not applied to the crowded markets where so many people are there?
Absolutely.
It's very clear that it's intimidation. The only thing is they don't realize that we don't get intimidated.
Yeah.
So we don't mind. Even if you want to arrest us, it's fine. We have already mentally prepared for that. Ek din to tum arrest bhi karoge, ek din to Gauri Lankesh jaisa bhi kisi ke saath aur karoge. So one is mentally prepared for that. So wo aisi gidar bhapkiyon se phir dar ke kya karna hai?
Sahi baat hai. No. Delhi officials really making mockery of themselves, I would say. Because all these incidents, ma'am, one thing really, Indu sir, you can come in. Police, Martin sir, with Martin Makwan on Hathras, we also did one event where Indu sir really hosted that program. Earlier also, when in US, we really knew that the backlash, which Black Lives Matter that started, there also the police reform having exclusionary behavior. Here also, the reforms in the police and law and justice, everything is so much required. And ma'am, you really highlighted that awareness and education starting from really from the kid level. But I think all our administration and all our system and institution need that orientation course more than the new generation. And it should be mandatory for them. And really for the implementing agency and the audacity by which the system is really making these things is something I don't think the young generation and people like me or people like you would accept. We will obviously, you know, rise up and say things. Thank you so much, ma'am. Indu sir, you are saying anything?
No, no, I think I just want to just say that, you know, Shabnam, just the experience that we had with the police beating the homeless black and blue in the nights, we have seen that, you know, in fact, I mentioned the book also, you know, that a child in Delhi wants to grow up to be a Hitler and kill all the policemen because at 8 years of age, when he was 8 years, he told me that, Shabnam, that he was beaten by the belts and boots of Delhi police. So this is the police brutality that happened with the child. And the Delhi police told one homeless, ki pad kya likha hai yahan pe? To bola, are itna padha likha hota to main to ye vardi pehen liya hota. To police wale kehte, bhag yahan se, faltu baat karte hai tu. Then he said, suno, ye DP likha hai. Ye Delhi police likha hai. But Delhi police nahi hum, hum India police hai, India police. So ye jo, what you're talking about, Shabnam, is that arrogance of the police, the power that they have, is unbridled power under the LG, not with the state government. I think that is what creates problem, you know, in the urban governance, especially in Delhi, in the capital. So, you know, I think, you know, this is a long struggle, Shabnam. I think, you know, the powers are skewed, the powers are patriarchal, the powers are anti-poor, the powers are anti-marginalized sections, excluded, you know, people who suffer. So I think we need to put up the fight. I think, the way you have been putting a fight for so many years, Shabnam, from the 80s till now, you know, I think it's inspirational for many of us. And we've been, some of us have been part of your fight as well, Shabnam. And I can only say that, you know, I think more strength to you. And I don't know whether Govindji is there, Arjun? Is Govindji there? Are we close the program?
No, I don't think she's there.
Yeah. So Shabnam, I think, you know, just to thank you for coming today and spending over 2 hours with us, you know, talking about issues that really, I think, impact large sections of women in our society today. Thank you for raising the issues so boldly and, you know, I think being very, very frank about it. I just want to thank you and just say that most into you, Shabnam. I think we are together in this struggle. And I think the hope lies there that we are together in the struggle and we shall change the stuff, you know, the stuff that's going on in the country as such, you know. So thanks a lot, Shabnam. And thanks a lot, everybody who's been listening to this program.
Zindabad, Shabnam. Thank you for inviting me.
Zindabad, Shabnam. Take care. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Have a good night, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you.